Good morning. How's everyone doing? Terrific. Well, welcome to HQ2 here at Amazon and to Amazon Visitor Landing. I'm Shannon Kellogg, and I'm the Vice President for Public Policy for AWS here in the Americas at Amazon. And it's so wonderful to see all of you here today and to have this very distinguished group of leaders with us to mark today's announcement and to discuss some really important issues. Today we're going to discuss issues that are important to the future of energy here in the U.S., including exciting announcements made today by Amazon and some of our critical partners. As the energy needs of our business and customers continue to grow, Amazon is thinking big about the challenges ahead. And we know that transitioning to carbon-free energy is one of the fastest ways to meet these needs while also addressing climate change. You're going to hear from a number of government leaders, as I've mentioned, as well as innovators and thought leaders across the energy sector and some of our key partners that are part of today's announcement. And all of them are on the forefront of the energy challenges and opportunities here in America. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to U.S. Secretary of Energy Jennifer Granholm. Virginia Governor Glenn Youngkin. U.S. Senator Tim Kaine. And U.S. Senator Mark Warner. We'll hear from each of them in just a minute. And I also wanted to take a minute to recognize some of the other officials who are in attendance here, including Virginia Secretary of Commerce and Trade Karen Merrick, who's on the panel. We also have Dame Karen Pierce, the British Ambassador of the United States of America. We also have the Honorable Dan Brulette, who is the former Secretary of Energy and the President of the Edison Electric Institute. We have Robin Carnahan, who's the General Services Administration Administrator. And Glenn Davis, the Director of the Department of Energy here in Virginia. And Mike Turner, on the Loudoun County Board of Supervisors. So we have the collection of federal, state, and local officials here, and you can see how important this is to every level of government. We'll also hear from a number of energy experts as part of the panel discussion, which I'm very excited about, including, as I mentioned, some of our key utility and energy partners, Dominion Energy, Energy Northwest, and X Energy. Now with that, I'd like to turn over the podium to the CEO of Amazon Web Services, Matt Garman. Matt, please join the stage.
Thanks, Shannon. And thank you all for coming. We really appreciate having you all here. We're very excited about the announcements that we have today. And glad you could be all here to share with us. Just a little bit of background for us. In 2019, Amazon signed the Climate Pledge, or created the Climate Pledge. And our goal was by 2040 to get to a carbon zero world. We didn't know how to do it. We didn't necessarily know the path to get there, but we knew it was important and an important goal for us to set. Today is an enormous milestone along that path. As we look towards the future, the energy needs of our world and our country are only really, they're escalating at an incredible rate. And so as we look forward over the next decade, we need tens of gigawatts more of power than we have today to power data centers, to power technology. And as the world continues to modernize, continues to digitize, as we think about the power of generative AI, all of these capabilities are leading to the demands of more power, which is a critical, critical component for us in the country here. And as we think about the technologies going forward of how we're gonna meet the demands of that power, and particularly as we think about carbon-free power, there's many of those investments that we make. We've made over 500 investments all around the world in wind energy, in solar energy, but those aren't gonna be enough. We're not gonna be able to create those fast enough. And so nuclear is an incredibly important part of reaching that carbon zero goal for us. Today, we have a couple of really big announcements that we're incredibly excited about. We have partnerships with two utilities here in the that are here represented today, Energy Northwest in Washington and Dominion here in Virginia, incredibly important partners of us on this journey to deliver carbon zero power to the world. Super important on that. We're also excited about a partnership with X-Energy, who's building technology behind small modular reactors. It's a new technology around nuclear power that's going to allow us to build smaller, self-contained power generation near data centers, near where we want, in a completely safe and scalable way. We are incredibly excited about that technology and the partnerships that we have with the utilities to help us go make that a reality and add energy into the country that we desperately need. And so thank you all for this important milestone. And again, this is a milestone along the path. There's a ton that we need to do between here and there, and there's a lot of work that needs to go into this, but this is a really important milestone that we're celebrating today, and really excited to have all of you here to support that. Thank you very much. Okay, sorry. All right, I guess we have a video now, so.
Almost everything that happens online depends on data centers, and in order to use them, we need energy. Amazon has committed to become net zero carbon by 2040, and that means innovating to power our businesses, including data centers, with carbon-free energy. Amazon has already invested in more than 500 wind and solar projects to date, and now we're building on that leadership by helping pioneer the future of nuclear energy technology. We've signed innovative agreements with three companies to develop next-generation nuclear reactors, known as small modular reactors, or SMRs. It is a safe and reliable source of energy that can help power our operations and meet the growing demands of our customers for decades to come.
X-Energy is a developer of next-generation advanced small modular nuclear power plants. And it starts with the fuel form in a round pebble about the size of a billiard ball. We take this amazing fuel form and we wrap it in successive layers of graphite and ceramics. And that provides a huge safety benefit. It ensures that this fuel form can't melt. We load the pebbles into the reactor column like gumballs in a gumball machine. And in a typical reactor, we would have 220,000. We initiate the nuclear chain reaction, and that heat is captured by helium and ultimately turned into steam that can be used to generate electricity and meet the power needs for a growing global economy and to meet new needs like the electrification of the vehicle fleet and the power needs of artificial intelligence.
Energy Northwest is a joint operating agency, or joint action agency, formed by the state of Washington to serve the public power utilities of the region. As we look forward and make efforts to decarbonize the electric system in the Northwest, we are projecting and expecting a significant development of renewable energy and energy storage in the region. The utilities in our region see a need for nuclear power. They've asked us to lead the way in developing this resource. That's where we appreciate the vision of Amazon, looking ahead to the future, seeing the need, and leveraging their abilities to help develop the technology.
Having partners who are interested in developing such a project with us not only protects our customers, it really protects all the parties interested in trying to develop as aggressively as possible large sources of carbon-free generation. We're building solar and offshore wind as fast as we can. But even then, we need more generation and more power to meet our customers' future needs. And that's where SMRs really come into play.
We're committed to working in partnership across the industry to make this a reality. We are a company of innovators and pioneers, and we're proud to support the future of nuclear power and pursue this work with that same spirit.
For those opening comments and for being here literally overnight from Seattle to make this event, so thank you so much. Now it's my honor to introduce our next speaker, who is currently serving as the 16th Secretary of Energy here in the United States of America, Jennifer Granholm, who prior serving in her current role was actually the 47th governor of Michigan. So we have all of these governors and former governors with us today, and Secretary Granholm is among that group. She has been an amazing champion of carbon neutral energy and technologies, and has been a strong advocate for nuclear and SMRs. And so it's a real honor to have her with us today. So Secretary Granholm, over to you.
Thanks so much, Shannon. This is a great day. All govs, former govs, you know, we know what it's like. We want to get stuff done. And Matt, we are thrilled to be able to partner on getting this particular project, but also their series of projects, I should say, but also making sure that nuclear is a choice that the hyperscalers believe is part of the solution to get to bringing clean power online. What great leadership on the part of AWS, and we're thrilled that AWS is the latest to BYOP, as we say, bring your own power to the build out of these data centers. I just want to set the stage for a second on this, because we've all been talking about how we are going to make sure that we pair utilities with the the data centers. Virginia, you guys are obviously the go-to place for the concentration of data centers, which means you have extra power needs that we don't want to see socialized along everyday citizens. And that's why the recognition that data powers are bringing their power is so critical to the strategy that we are developing inside the Biden-Harris administration. We started convening hyperscalers about almost a year ago to have this conversation and talk about anticipated power needs. We've laid our cards on the table. We want these data centers to be built in the United States for a variety of reasons, including national security reasons. We want these to be built in the United States. And we know we need additional power to be able to do that. And we want that power to be clean power. And fortunately, all of the major hyperscalers are committed, like AWS's leadership on this has been just amazing and wonderful. But you're not the only one. Others also have those kinds of commitments. So it's a great opportunity. And we know that the grid is capable of adding the volume that's necessary. And the question is how we can help you do it. And let me just say, we've given a bit of a jump start on this. Just to put it in perspective, the facts are that modelers are saying that over the next few years, data center electricity demand will roughly double. From right now, it's 4 to 6% of the load total, about 9% in 2027. In Virginia, it's going to be more than that because of this concentration. When you add in new factories that are being built across the country because of the Inflation Reduction Act and the bipartisan infrastructure law, you add in electrification of transportation, we know that we are going to need a huge new volume. But let me just tell you, we have done this before as a nation. So for example, prior to 2005, there was a 30% growth in demand for power on the electric grid, which we met in a decade, that 30%. And so just to give you some hope that this is possible, because of the Biden-Harris administration's Invest in America agenda, the Inflation Reduction Act and the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law, the incentives in those acts have made it irresistible for developers of clean power to choose to grow that clean power in America. And therefore, this year alone, we will be adding 60 gigawatts of clean power to the grid. That's 30 Hoover dams worth of power to the grid in 1 year. That's more than twice what we have delivered in any year. So those incentives are having an impact. And that those incentives, we know that we can do that again. So we've got better incentives. We have better partnerships than we've had before. We have better, public tools, better information, better technologies than we've had before. So we're excited about that. And we know that we've got to power, and this is the important piece, as I mentioned, that the technology companies know that in order for these data centers to achieve great community buy-in, bringing their own power with them is an important piece of that, so that the rates are not raised on everyday citizens. So we've got a lot going on. The incentives from the Inflation Reduction Act include this clean energy investment tax credit. That's one thing. And then DOE got billions of dollars additionally in loans to be able to partner with companies who want to build out clean power. And hats off to the senators here who were so instrumental in making those bills happen. And what you're seeing across the country, not just in Virginia, you should feel really, really great about, because we are really the go-to place for these technologies and building out the deployment of them. Companies who choose to locate their power centers in places like abandoned coal mines, old power plants, they get additional incentives. There's additional juice in the incentives for that. If they pay prevailing wage, if they use domestic content, they get additional tax incentives. So you could get a 50% off the top of your project because of the incentives for locating in America, for locating in communities that may be bruised by the loss of power plants. And if you do well by your workers. So this is it's an exciting moment, and it really does make communities like Virginia that have old power plants and coal mines irresistible as well. So we know that all of these tax credits and technologies and community buy-in, it's all complicated. It's complex. These are not easy projects to bring forward. And so we at DOE want to offer, as I was saying to you earlier, Matt, a handshake, a friendship, to be able to do what we can to partner with you on how can we be helpful in sites, how can we be helpful in permitting, how can we be helpful in the grid enhancing technologies that are necessary to make these sites a go. We want to do all of that and to be partners on those as well. We've got hundreds of sites that we know you can get that extra amount of tax incentives for as well. I just want to say that the technology companies, you all solve all these great problems. You identify these problems, you solve all these great problems. Once you're done solving, you're saying, what's next? What's next? What's the next big thing? Obviously, AI is just such huge opportunity to help solve problems, even as it brings its challenges with it. And so, we this daring to ask what the next frontier is a critical part of how DOE's DNA has been. We consider ourselves the solutions department because we have 17 national labs that have been working in various ways on a lot of these technologies. And obviously SMR, small modular reactors, are a huge piece of how we're going to solve this puzzle of getting to 100% clean electricity by 2035 while responding to all of the demand that will be created as a result of the data centers and the other and the new factories, et cetera, that are coming online. I want to announce that today DOE is announcing $900 million in funding for those who want to deploy even more SMR, small modular reactors. That's another piece of what we are bringing to this. We've called this Nuclear Week because at this moment, as I speak, we're also having a meeting at our Idaho National Labs, which does so much development of our nuclear strategy for investors who want to invest in SMRs and who may be not sure about this technology. So we want to take down the mystery and make sure that the investment world understands the importance of this technology and its likelihood of success. So ultimately, I think what we're starting here is a race to the top. And the bigger and bolder these companies dream, the greater the rewards will be for all of us, where America is leading this future. This 21st century future of clean energy technologies in partnership with the private sector. We say that this transition, this energy transition, is private sector led, government enabled, and we want to be that enabling partner for you, and we want to, with you, ask what's next. So congratulations to AWS for taking this step toward the future. Thank you for answering the call. And I, as I close my remarks, I just have to apologize because I have another engagement, so I'm going to have to leave and not be able to have the benefit of hearing the glorious speeches that you are going to be given. I'm so sorry, but please forgive me and know that we are partners. All right, thanks so much, everybody.
Well, thank you, Secretary. As always, very inspiring remarks. And as you can hear, I mean, she continues to be just a fantastic leader on these issues. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, the 74th governor of the Commonwealth of Virginia, Governor Glenn Youngkin. Governor Youngkin has been an advocate for innovation in developing Virginia's energy approach to deliver reliable, affordable, and increasingly clean power for the Commonwealth's future. This includes recently signing legislation to accelerate the development, testing, and deployment of small nuclear reactors to meet the power demands of Virginia. So please join me in welcoming to the stage Governor Youngkin.
Thank you. Well, what a day this is. This is another giant step towards a destination that we know we all have to arrive at, which is, in fact, an America and a Virginia that has affordable and reliable and increasingly clean power. And so first, Matt, thank you for hosting today and your support for this great initiative. Shannon, thank you for the great job you're doing in keeping us moving, not just here, but across all of these initiatives. I want to thank the senators for attending. We do a lot together, and so thank you for the collaboration. And of course, I want to thank the secretary for participating today. Since 2 years ago, we laid out in Virginia an all-American, all-of-the-above energy plan. And it was based on a basic truth that power demand is escalating at an unprecedented rate. And in fact, power supply was falling behind. And in fact, the idea that we were going to use the existing technology and the existing base of knowledge to meet that growing demand, unfortunately, was going to fall woefully short. And so I challenged Virginia to take this moment and declare our own moonshot that we do these things not because they are easy, but because they are hard. A moment for us to set a 10-year goal of deploying a commercial modular nuclear reactor in Virginia. And my friends, what a moment that was. You see, it was a moonshot moment, I believe, for Virginia and our nation when the rapidly growing need for affordable and reliable and increasingly clean power actually meets innovation. A moment where Virginia and America's most abundant resource, the power to innovate, comes together with a demand for next generation innovation in the world of technology. And when these two great forces meet, something spectacular happens. And it's a safe nuclear reaction. A moment where we can meet this demand with the most abundant commodity that we have in America today, innovation. And that is the spirit of America. And that's why I am so excited about this giant step that we are taking today. You see, all American works. It works because it rests on American innovation. And therefore, I firmly believe that at the core to this giant step are these innovative, visionary partners. And I want to thank Amazon Web Services for taking the initiative to believe that there is a different way to meet these needs. I want to thank X Energy for innovating and giving people a view to how to get there. I want to thank our partners at Dominion for facilitating and bringing all of their capabilities. And I particularly want to thank all of you for doing it here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. You see, I am thrilled that Virginia is among the first states to take this big step. A big step where just 2.5 years ago, Virginia was literally accelerating on what has been an uninterrupted renaissance in growth, in job growth, in investment by companies who've committed $83 billion to expand or come to Virginia and hire more people than we've ever had working before in the history of the Commonwealth. And yet that growth provides also an opportunity, because with that growth comes an unprecedented growth in power demand from amazing industries: indoor agriculture, advanced manufacturing, machine learning, artificial intelligence, data centers, cybersecurity. These energy-intensive industries require a new way of thinking about power supply. And that's what today is all about. In Virginia, we went to work. We recognized that affordable and reliable and increasingly clean power wasn't going to happen on its own. So the first thing we did was bring power costs down, bringing out costs that were burdening ratepayers' bills, $350 million of excess charges, taxes that weren't necessary. And on top of that, facilitating legislation for the deployment of small modular reactors. On top of that, we've just launched the creation of the Virginia Clean Energy Innovation Bank. We created the Virginia Power Innovation Fund that supports higher education research in our extraordinary institutions of higher learning, where we are home to some of the most advanced thinking in America. And on top of that, it works, because we're watching Virginia generate more power with less carbon. We can do this, and we can do this all the while relying on, again, what we have an abundance of: innovation capacity. And so finally, in my big ploy for why Virginia must be the continuing home of this, it's not just what is happening today, but it's the infrastructure that has existed for so long. You see, being the home to the nuclear Navy, being the home to a utility that operates the only two commercial scale nuclear reactors with 80-year licenses, being the home to universities that press the envelope on our thinking, being the home to the greatest workforce in the nation, being the home to a state that, yes, was named by CNBC as the best state for doing business, we are poised to take this giant step with our partners. And so again, I want to thank Amazon Web Services, because you see, accolades are one thing, but when you have a trusted partner who has chosen Virginia to have their second headquarters, a trusted partner who just about 20 months ago committed to invest $35 billion in extending their data center footprint across the Commonwealth, a trusted partner who again says that this giant step forward in power innovation can happen in Virginia in partnership with Dominion. That is a vote of confidence that desires a collective thank you from all Virginians. And so to Amazon Web Services, to Dominion, I say thank you. Thank you as a governor who understands that you could choose to go anywhere, and you chose to be here. It is that spirit of innovation, and it is this spirit of tomorrow that I think lies at the foundation of the big step that we are all going to take. And the best part about it is we get to take it together. And so thank you for this moment to celebrate, but then I challenge us to get ready to spring to the next milestone to make sure that we meet the challenge of our moonshot moment, which is to deploy the first commercial small modular reactor here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Governor Youngkin. We really appreciate you also joining us today and for your continued leadership on these issues and partnership with our company and our industry. We're so grateful. Now I'd like to introduce another leader who has been a longtime champion of carbon-free energy, U.S. Senator Tim Kaine. Senator Kaine has been a strong advocate for the role of nuclear energy in meeting our carbon-free energy needs. He works in the Senate, or his work in the Senate has supported advancements in nuclear technology, safety regulations, and the responsible expansion of nuclear power as a vital part of our carbon-free energy mix, in the, both here and in the future. Senator Kaine also serves as a senior member of the Senate Armed Services Committee, helping oversee our country's military and defense policy. Prior to being elected to the U.S. Senate, he also served as the 70th governor of Virginia. So, Senator Kaine, we really appreciate your leadership on military, defense, and energy policy issues, which really makes you a pivotal voice in the future of nuclear energy. Please join me in welcoming Senator Tim Kaine.
Well, thank you, Shannon and Matt, and to all the AWS family for hosting this very exciting announcement today. It's great to be with our governor, Secretary Granholm, my colleague, Senator Warner. Shannon, when he stood up at the beginning, he said he had a very distinguished group of visitors, and it reminded me I was once in Latin America, and someone was welcoming the group but said it was he wanted to welcome the extinguished visitors. So I chuckled as Shannon began welcoming the distinguished group, but it is a distinguished group for a very important day. Ambassador Pierce, really good to have you here as well. The US-UK innovation partnership is so strong, so I'm not surprised to have you here. I want to put this in context about Virginia and energy, and then I want to say a word about this particular innovation in small modular reactors. In context, I've been in the Senate for 12 years now, and three times I have been the deciding vote on an important piece of legislation. Those days you remember. There are days when things go slow, there are days when, you know, it seems like, are we ever going to get there? But then there are the days when it's a tie vote or you're the deciding vote and you walk out sometimes at 3 a.m. and think, I know why I'm here. I know why I'm here. One of those votes was the Inflation Reduction Act. The Inflation Reduction Act essentially had three components. One was to dramatically bring down prescription drug costs. One was to fix the Black Lung Benefit Program, which is of significant importance in Virginia for coal mining retirees. But the third piece were the set of incentives, tax credits, and investments in a clean energy economy that Secretary Granholm laid out when she was talking in her speech. And some of them are very particular to Virginia. The added incentives for energy communities really, really work in Virginia on top of all the other incentives. What we have seen since the IRA has passed in Virginia has been absolutely dramatic. Virginia was not really thought of as a leader in clean energy nationally. When I came into the Senate, we were deep in the bottom half in deployment of solar. We're in the top 10 now. We're in the lead in this country in the development of offshore wind in Virginia. We're able to do significant manufacturing investments. The governor was able to announce an investment by a Korean firm, Greenlink, in Chesapeake, a huge manufacturing facility that will build the cables connecting offshore wind power into the grid. The governor was able to announce a Danish company, Topsoe, locating in Chesterfield to make components for hydrogen fuel cells, which can be a clean power source in the future. We were able to announce a huge investment by Volvo in the heart of Appalachia, Pulaski County, to expand Volvo's ability to produce over-the-road vehicles that are electric. All of these driven by hundreds of millions of dollars of incentives because of the Inflation Reduction Act. And the announcement today of the $900 million that is being directed into SMRs as grants, together with the tax incentives that are available, we are just seeing a huge powering, not only of clean energy across the country and America claiming dominance in the world in terms of our innovation, but we're seeing right here in Virginia that we can create cleaner power and create great jobs at the same time. Now, to put it in the more focused area on small modular reactors, if you ask people, you know, what state in America is the nuclear innovator, people might think Oak Ridge, Tennessee. People might think Hanford, Washington. People might think Idaho because of the labs, but I'm here to tell you that Virginia is the lead innovator in this country with respect to nuclear, and I'm going to pick up a little bit on what Governor Youngkin said. First, nuclear power produced in Virginia. The national average is 18% of our power nationally is produced by nuclear energy. In Virginia, it's 36%. We are a unique leader in using nuclear power, and we have been for decades, and that's been to the benefit of our consumers and our businesses. Second, the governor mentioned the nuclear Navy. For decades, we have built nuclear-powered subs and carriers at the shipyard in Newport News, and we've done it reliably, and we've done it safely. These ships are built in the middle of a huge metropolitan area with a safety record that is truly stellar. Stellar by our own terms, stellar by global terms. Where are those reactors made that go into the ships and subs? They're made in Lynchburg. They're made by two firms in Lynchburg, BWXT and Framatome, the centers for innovation that make the nuclear reactors that power our nuclear Navy. And that's not all that's made in Lynchburg. At these firms in Lynchburg, now we are innovating on the technology that we will need to get to Mars. You cannot get to Mars off traditional jet fuel. You need nuclear propulsion to get to Mars. And that work is being done in Lynchburg, Virginia. So whether it's our use of nuclear power, whether it's our deployment of nuclear power for consumer purposes, our expertise with respect to the nation's military, and our innovation on next steps to get us to Mars, Virginia is the center of this. Virginia is the center of this. And that's why this particular announcement by this great Virginia company, AWS, who has chosen us as one of its two headquarters, who is the largest power user in the United States. It used to be Walmart about 10 years ago. Now Amazon is the largest power user in the United States. That AWS is here and that AWS is endeavoring to help us advance our innovation together with these other innovators in Virginia makes perfect sense. It is good state policy that makes us a great state for business and a state energy plan that challenges us to go farther. It's fantastic private sector partners. But it is also the kind of legislation like the Inflation Reduction Act. I mean, a one-vote margin could have gone the other direction. But as the secretary said, private sector-led, but enabled by good public policy. And that's really worth celebrating, and I'm so glad to be with you today. Thanks so much, and congratulations.
Thank you, Senator Kaine, as always, for being here and for your continued leadership on these issues. Well, our next speaker is the senior senator from Virginia, U.S. Senator Mark Warner. Senator Warner has favored an all-of-the-above portfolio approach, understanding the need to employ a multitude of carbon-free sources, including solar, wind, and nuclear energy. Earlier this year, Senator Warner launched an advanced nuclear caucus in the Senate to amplify the critical role nuclear energy plays in the U.S. and to explore emerging nuclear technologies, which, by the way, makes a lot of sense to me because Senator Warner is the first U.S. senator that I actually ever had a detailed conversation about SMRs with, which he initiated. And further, Senator Warner is also the chairman of the Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence, where he is a leading voice on national security issues in the U.S., including on the criticality of developing SMRs. He's been very vocal about this. Prior to being elected to the U.S. Senate, he served as the 69th governor of Virginia. Please welcome Senator Mark Warner, chairman of the Intelligence Committee.
Well, thank you, Shannon. Thank you for that introduction. It is great to be back at HQ2. I think the last time I was here, we had a forum where we were talking about affordable housing issues. And I do want to thank Amazon again for making the smart choice to choose the Commonwealth of Virginia. And you are a great neighbor and a great asset to the Commonwealth. Don't want to contradict anyone who's already spoke before me, but you know, damn, I thought I was deciding vote on the IRA. You know, those one vote margin things, we all get to claim that. So, but this is a long time coming. You know, I've been an advocate for nuclear power for over a decade. And I think, you know, if we look back a decade ago, we thought the nuclear industry was gonna go through a transformation in that 2015, 2016, time frame, and candidly, I think there were promises from the industry that we just didn't meet. And there was still a large reluctance, I think, from many policymakers, I mean, probably disproportionately on the Democratic side, that didn't think this ought to be part of our portfolio. That has fundamentally changed. And while I celebrate and approve all that we've done in solar and wind, and again, I want to thank our friends at Dominion for the progress they've made, the offshore wind project. But the truth is, if we're going to power all these data centers, solar and wind alone isn't going to get it. You need that consistent 24/7 power that is available, affordable, and clean. And one of the things that has kind of got me, because I've been spending, and Shannon indicated, a lot of time on this subject. And Tim and I have talked about it. The governor and I have had countless conversations. I remember one time with Jennifer, we were sitting around in our conference room kind of brainstorming on how we get this moving forward. Like, why are we, the policymakers, trying to think up the deal structure when, frankly, it should be coming from the utilities? And I salute Dominion, but every utility wants to be the third purchaser of an SMR. Nobody wants to be number one or number two. And the governor and I have spent a lot of time, how do we put this deal structure together? Well, I think with today's announcement, and candidly with a couple other of the hyperscaler announcements, Google and Microsoft, and there are a host of others, that we are finally cracking that code. And to make this happen, and I say this again, and really value our friendship and partnership with Amazon, but we are going to need, and there are about 7 to 8 hyperscalers that are going to be, you know, in the AI business, in the data center business, and with this enormous power needs, you've got to have a total mix, and I think nuclear and SMRs in particular will be a critical component of that. And since the secretary left, anybody still here from DOE? All right, then I'm proud to announce that all that $900 million she just announced is coming to Virginia for our project. Well, she didn't leave staff behind, but, you know, and I do want to circle back because there are a series of buckets that are available out of the IRA and some other legislation we've passed. Why am I so passionate about this? And as Shannon mentioned, I'm chairman of the Intelligence Committee. And if I have to look at that job in one holistic way, it is in 2024 and the years going forward to redefine national security as not simply the nation state that has the most tanks and guns and ships and planes, but increasingly it's going to be who can win the battle in technology competition. And in so many ways, I think again about the competition, people have mentioned AI a few years back. I still remember Kai-Fu Lee's kind of seminal work saying who had the most data, who had the most compute, who had the most engineers, and many folks thought that China might win that battle. But because of innovation from America, you know, you look at the top 10 AI companies in the world, you can slice or dice it anyway, 8 or 9 of them are all American. And in domain after domain, we are at the lead. But energy generation is one of those areas. And in this one, we, frankly, have got work to do. And I think I'm, as I've been mentioned, I'm for all of the above on energy power as we make the transition to more fuller, clean energy. But in China, we have a competitor in nuclear that at this point in time is, frankly, a little bit ahead. You know, we are, as mentioned, in Virginia, I didn't know we were at 36. I knew we were above 30 nuclear power, I think 18% to 19% on a national basis. China is constructing 30 nuclear plants even as we speak. They have a goal of adding 150 more between now and 2035. And let's face it, their regulatory process is a little bit easier than ours. Just as we saw for most of the 20th century, if you become dependent on an energy source, that compromises your ability on a whole series of arenas. And we saw most of the 20th century where we in America were dependent, I believe, too much on Middle Eastern oil. Well, if a nation state signs a 30 or 50 year contract to buy SMRs from a Chinese entity, they are going to be reliant upon that source of energy for that 30 to 50 year time frame. And what we found, particularly now in this competition with China, there is a moment in time right now, because there's a lot of nations that signed up to the Chinese Belt and Road Initiative, where China would promise great infrastructure investments and bring workers and provide financing. Well, candidly, the work product that came out of a lot of that, a lot of those projects on Belt and Road, they didn't get the workers. The projects themselves are not that well put together, and those nation states are deep in debt. Nations around the world want to buy American nuclear power and American SMRs. But the question I hear back all the time from, as I meet with folks from around the world on this subject is, well, if this is so great, why aren't you doing more of it in America? And that, I think, has been, we as policymakers, been the question that we've not been able to crack the code. The announcement today, along with a couple of these other announcements, I think is cracking that code. And while we celebrate this with announcement with AWS, I do need to acknowledge that the governor, the senator, and I wouldn't mind a few other hyperscalers making similar nuclear announcements in Virginia. We have turned the corner in terms of the legislative approach. Tim went through the various components on the IRA, and the DOE loan program is about $300 billion, the $900 million that the secretary announced today. There are a series of other buckets in the IRA. All that's good news. What's also good news is that we've been, frankly, lacking in terms of the energy sources that power these reactors, uranium and other minerals. We passed a $2.7 billion investment in energy security around our fuel sources, bipartisan. We passed a recent, and the president signed, legislative action to make the nuclear regulatory process of approval. We hope this facility will be built at North Anna, down in Louisa County, but we've got to make that process not a, 10-year plus regulatory approval process. We can do this safely, smartly, with a much shorter process, and the NRC, I think, understands that. And these pieces of legislation were overwhelmingly bipartisan. Little easier than the IRA, these both the fuel security and the regulatory reforms, north of 80 votes. So you've got a consensus. The vast majority of mainstream, both political parties, think nuclear has to be a major component. And Jim Risch, who represents Idaho, we have started an SMR caucus in the Senate, and we've got an awful lot of senators who want to be part of that. Final point I want to make, and this is building on what happens when you're the last speaker. The governor and the junior senator took all my good lines, but you're going to hear them again. We are the nuclear capital for the country. 100,000 Virginians. You add BWXT, Framatome, some of the ancillary entities that support those in the Lynchburg area, what HI and others are doing in terms of the shipyard. And it was always a little bit hypocritical, I thought, when, again, disproportionately folks on my side of the aisle were complaining or concerned about building additional nuclear plants in America, yet never seemed to be concerned about putting our sailors on nuclear-powered aircraft carriers or submarines. I think we've, again, turned that corner. But we have that 100,000 workers committed. I want to thank the governor for his moonshot approach. I think it makes a great deal of sense in building all of these our universities, our world-class universities, to make sure we've got the workforce there. I want to close out with a lot of time I've spent with Huntington Ingalls, the shipyards. Nuclear is their largest growing component part of their business. And as we think about SMRs, one of the challenges, when we look at the last couple facilities that have been built down in Georgia, the Vogtle plants, much larger, 1,000 megawatts, we couldn't bring the economies of scale with these smaller modular reactors, the 200 to 300 megawatts, that frankly, that casting and that kind of equipment can be built at HI and then shipped out around the country in a way that helps bring the cost down dramatically. We hope that this will be the first of many announcements. The governor and I and Tim are working with a couple of other sister states. If there was ever a chance for us to think boldly and try to get, you know, a dozen plus of these reactors announced so that we can take down that first of kind risk that I know our utility friends in the Northwest and our friends at Dominion face, we want to be there side by side to make sure that we lead on this in this development. We think it will happen. We want to make Virginia the capital of that. We don't mind if Washington State becomes second or third in that process. But it all starts with, I think, the kind of creativity that AWS brought to this process. And we thank them for selecting Virginia as a HQ2, upward and onward. Thank you all very much.
Well, thank you, Senator Warner. And as always, really appreciate the leadership in this area and the emphasis that you and Senator Kaine and Governor Youngkin all made around the national security implications of what's ahead of us. So thank you so much for your leadership and all of you, what you continue to do. We're going to transition to our esteemed panel next. And I know some of our leaders may have to leave us. But if we could just give them another hand for their participation this morning. We're really grateful for this community of policymakers, and quite frankly, all of you in the stakeholder community as we look ahead to the future of energy within our own operations and beyond. And I would now like to welcome our panel of experts as they bring the chairs on the stage to join on the stage. Maybe I should have said that more slowly, as they now transition and put chairs on the stage. When that happens, we'll ask you to join us. And as they're doing that, I also would like to acknowledge, you know, as you've heard, you've read in the press release, hopefully, and you've heard in some of the remarks today, Washington State is also a very important part of our announcement. And we did invite Senator Cantwell and Murray, Senator Murray, to also be here, and Governor Inslee, but given this is on the East Coast, they were not able to join us. In the case of Senator Cantwell, she's in a re-election campaign and campaigning out west, and Senator Murray is also working hard on the campaign trail in support of a number of candidates, and Governor Inslee was not able to make it today, but he has a quote in the press release. I want to thank them, and if we could also, in their absence, give them a hand for all of their leadership as well, because they've been absolutely critical leaders in the Senate, at the federal level, and at the state level on these issues. And without their help, we couldn't have made the Washington State component of this, which is also critical, happen. So I again want to thank all of the leaders that we're working with on a bipartisan basis on these issues. So if now that we have our chairs on the stage, if we could ask Kevin Miller, the Vice President of Global Data Centers at AWS, to join us, along with our key partners, starting with Clay Sell, the CEO of X Energy, Greg Cullen, the Vice President of Energy Northwest, and Ed Bain, President of Dominion Energy in Virginia. And then, as I mentioned before, Karen Merrick, the Secretary of Commerce and Trade for the Commonwealth of Virginia, is also joining us in this session today. And finally, we have Rich Powell, the CEO of the Clean Energy Buyers Association, who will be moderating our panel discussion today. During today's discussion, we'll discuss our news, as well as explore the potential of small modular nuclear reactors. And as we continue to confront with the challenges, or be confronted with the challenges of climate change, the need for reliable, scalable, and carbon-free energy solutions has never been more critical. So, Rich, we appreciate all of your leadership in this space as well, and for you joining us. Thank you so much, and the podium is turned over to you.
Good morning, everybody. What an amazing day. What an amazing day. So first, an enormous thanks to Shannon and Matt and the entire Amazon and AWS team for having all of us here together for this incredible announcement. And again, a huge thanks to Secretary Granholm, to Governor Youngkin, to Senators Kaine and Warner for this remarkable display of can-do bipartisan leadership. Can we all just just one more round of applause for this amazing display of bipartisanship. I think what folks may not fully appreciate about this announcement is this is the result of nearly a decade of bipartisan policymaking here in DC that began with things like the Energy Act of 2020 and the Advanced Reactor Demonstration Program launched by Secretary Dan Brouillette in the previous administration, which selected and enabled X-Energy, and its demonstration is one of several reactors that our country is investing in a grand public-private partnership that's now been ably taken forward in this administration with strong bipartisan support across the board from both chambers of Congress. So it's an incredible, this might be the most bipartisan thing happening right now in clean energy policy in the United States. So very, very exciting. Just a quick introduction to our organization. The Clean Energy Buyers Association represents 400 companies. 200 of them are major buyers of electricity. Obviously, we're delighted to have the country's largest purchaser of electricity. Amazon is a founding member and a board member of CEBA. Collectively, our members have more than $20 trillion in market cap and have deployed, as of Q2 this year, more than 84 gigawatts of clean energy contracted across the country and hundreds more around the world. So, this remarkable day shows real innovation, both in advanced nuclear technology, but also in public-private partnerships and in innovative business models to develop and deploy a technology like this, and particularly in displaying how a very large corporate buyer can come together with regulated utilities to advance and deploy this technology. And so we've got an incredible set of folks. Shannon introduced everyone. I'll just say one more word about everyone. So Kevin Miller is the Vice President of Global Data Centers at Amazon. He's responsible for planning, engineering, design, delivery, and operations. That's a lot of Amazon's global data center and renewable energy infrastructure, spanning just 34 regions, more than 600 points of presence, and hundreds of carbon-free energy projects. And he's been with AWS for 16 years and seemingly led every business function here at AWS. We have, of course, Secretary Karen Marek, the Secretary of Commerce and Trade for the Commonwealth of Virginia since January of 22. She leads economic growth for the state. She oversees just 13 agencies with 1,300 team members and a $3 billion budget, including but not limited to the Virginia Economic Development Partnership, the Virginia Innovation Partnership Corporation, and Virginia Energy. And she has over 25 years of experience driving economic growth and business here in the great state of Virginia. We have Clay Sell, the CEO of X Energy. He has extensive experience both in U.S. and international energy, in renewables development, and obviously most recently in advanced nuclear, traditional energy development, and of course he was the Deputy Secretary of Energy just ever. So we have lots of governors and lots of Secretaries of Energy and Deputy Secretaries of Energy in presence here. We have Greg Cullen, the Vice President for Energy Services and Development at Energy Northwest. He's been at Energy Northwest since 93. He currently runs Energy Northwest's non-nuclear generating plants and the development of new projects in clean energy generation and storage. And previously, he held a number of roles, including in supporting the operation of the Columbia Generating Station, the Northwest's only operating nuclear energy facility. And last but certainly not least, we have Ed Bain. He's the president of Dominion Energy Virginia, a vertically integrated electricity utility with generation, transmission, and distribution assets serving 2.7 million customers in Virginia and Northeast Carolina, probably including HQ2, I assume. Yep, key account. And he's been with Dominion since 95 when he was an associate engineer. He's on the boards of directors of the Chamber RVA, Venture Richmond, among other things, and the Board of Visitors and Rector at Virginia Tech and EPRI's Research Advisory Committee. So we could not have a better group of folks to share more about this really exciting set of announcements. Greg, we're gonna start with you. I think folks are really interested in how this project will work and how your company as a utility will oversee it. Can you tell us a little bit more about your plans and what we can expect in these next steps here?
Yeah, if you bear with me though, let me go back a little bit in time. So 2019, Washington State passed the Clean Energy Transformation Act, basically mandating that the utilities in the state map out and head start down a pathway to 100% clean electricity generation by 2045. In January of 2020, we released the results of a study we had commissioned that concluded that the least cost system to accomplish 100% clean energy included a significant amount of nuclear in it. Armed with those two things, and as was mentioned, being the only nuclear operator in the Northwest, that really led us to get a little more intense and serious about exploring the possibility of bringing new nuclear generation to the Northwest to help the states in Washington, and then of course Oregon subsequently passed a similar bill to kind of figure out how to accomplish that goal and meet those requirements. Later in 2020, we chose to partner with X-Energy on their Advanced Reactor Demonstration Program application, successful application, of course. That started a long journey for us in working with X-Energy on the idea of using their technology to deploy it on one of our sites in the state of Washington to help meet those requirements. We have worked with X-Energy intensely through that time. In 2023, we signed a joint development agreement with them to be the fast follower project behind the Dow project in Texas. And that's been our goal throughout that time. We have a site located right next to the Columbia Generating Station that was previously permitted for nuclear construction. It's had environmental work, it's had licensing work done on it. We know a lot about the site. Again, it's right next to our operating unit. We've done a lot of work just in the last 5 years around that site to move us further down the path. We have, not the least of things I should point out, is we have a community that is very, very nuclear knowledgeable, educated and experienced, and not only is not against this project, but is very, very incredibly supportive of this project, as Clay can attest. This community is very much wants us to bring this to our community, to the Tri-Cities in Washington State. We have recently received from the Washington State government $25 million towards our project, which is a major sign of where our state's government is in the importance of nuclear in the mix. So we have a site that we believe makes us one of the fastest places to deploy this technology in the country. We have done a lot of work over the last 4 or 5 years. We've assembled a strong, talented staff, and we'll keep adding to that. And we're gonna build on that and all the things that we have done working with X-Energy, all the knowledge we have of that technology, the site we have, the community support we have, we're gonna build on that to go be the second deployment behind the Dow project. And we're excited about this. We're excited about the vision of Amazon and what they've brought to this. One of the things I do want to make sure I point out, it's been alluded to a couple times today, you know, concerns about this idea. Well, are data centers going to take all this power and leave everyone else in the dark? And what we've really appreciated about this partnership with Amazon is that they share the vision with us that not only are they bringing their own power to their needs, but they see this as a pathway to help allow utilities to follow behind and take advantage of these technologies as they take on the really early mover, higher level of risk and costs. And so we're excited about that. I should also mention, you know, we received $10 million from Puget Sound Energy, an investor-owned utility in the state of Washington that is very excited about this as well and looking to potentially be a part of this first project as well. So we see that utility Amazon partnership already. So we're very excited about this, but that's what we're poised and ready to go. We've been preparing for this day for quite some time. We have everything lined up and we're ready to execute.
Greg, thank you so much. And just thank you in particular for the reminder of the community's embrace of projects like this. You know, I think we're seeing across the country as nuclear communities embrace taking on more of this energy, as communities hosting wind and solar projects see the economic benefits of these things. It's leading to significantly increased support around the country. So I think very, very important to remember. Ed, we're going to come next to you. You're also a utility. You're approaching SMRs and nuclear energy in a slightly different way. And you've also signed an agreement with Amazon, and you have an open RFP for other ideas. And can you share a little bit more about how you're approaching the space?
Yeah, so we have a lot to do in Virginia. If you've paid attention to our integrated resource plan that we had announced yesterday, 27 gigawatts of power to be built over the next 15 years. And whatever you name, it's yes, more of all of that. And so as you think about small modular reactors, we're very happy to be able to partner with Amazon AWS has been a long customer of ours. We want them to continue to be a long customer of ours. As you think about the first mover, early mover on nuclear, it's a way that you can help mitigate risk to customers while still advancing the technology, and appreciate Amazon's willingness to think about a structure that could absolutely do that. Now, as you think about the request for proposal, we announced that on July 10th, and we were at our North Anna site, and the governor, among others, were there with us. And we have done a lot of early site separation work. It was for a previous North, what we call North Anna 3, and so, again, it's a site that is well on its way to be able to be developed. Louisa County is very supportive of additional nuclear within that community. And through that request for proposal, we've spent a lot of time on technology, but we want to get deeper with all of those companies about supply chain, about the fuel sourcing, as well as what kind of support and structure that they can help as we bring projects to bear. But we're committed that new nuclear has to be part of our mix for Virginia's future.
Clay, I'm going to come next to you. So in the end, getting costs down for SMRs is all about scale. The way that the buying community and the utility community was able to get costs down for wind and solar was standardizing on a few designs and ruthlessly driving to scale, and that brought costs down. Tell us about your path to scale and how these kinds of collaborations are going to enable X Energy to scale.
Thank you, Rich. Is this on? Yeah, thank you, Rich, and thank you to Matt Garman and the broader Amazon team for hosting us. Today's announcement from Amazon plays a huge role in getting us to scale. And let me talk about it in a number of different aspects. First, Amazon, from the Climate Pledge Fund, is leading a $500 million financing round that we're announcing today. Their leadership enabled capital to follow, including from Citadel founder and CEO Ken Griffin, including from our partner of the last 2 years, Ares Management, including NGP, who is also here with us today, and including the University of Michigan Endowment. So their selection of us, their investment in us, enabled a platinum class group of investors to come along to continue to fund the company, on top of the leadership we've received from our founder, Cam Gaffarian, for 16 years. So that's piece number one. Secondly, as part of this partnership, they are committed to providing and enabling additional capital to actually build plants. And if there is anything truly different about this announcement today, it is that. Many, many companies that desire clean power have said, we will buy under PPAs all the clean power you can provide. No company like Amazon has come along and said, we are prepared to provide capital and enable additional capital to actually build these plants. And they're going to do that in partnership with Energy Northwest. I know they endeavor to do that in partnership with Dominion and with many other sites to come, because they have targeted 5 gigawatts of XE100 plants over the next 15 years. It's an extraordinary announcement. It's the largest target that any company like that has announced. And we are just tremendously proud to be in partnership with the leading hyperscaler globally, in addition to being in partnership with the leading chemical manufacturer globally, with Dow, where we are developing our first plant with them in Texas. So this quality of partners, this quality of investors, the opportunities to work with Dow, the opportunities to work with Amazon, the opportunity to work with Energy Northwest, give us the momentum and the scale to drive technology deployment costs down, so XE100s truly become the preferred clean, firm, 24/7 power source you know, to really drive the next generation of artificial intelligence and, quite frankly, the continued growth of the U.S. economy.
Clay, I'm going to ask you one follow-up question for the benefit of the folks in the room that aren't energy nerds, which might be several of the folks in the room. What does 5 gigawatts of 24/7 clean power mean? Dimensionalize that for us. How important is that?
You can think of that as 800 to a million American households. 800,000 to a million American households. So it's a huge amount of power.
It's a lot of power. Kevin, you oversee the global data center operation here at AWS. We know that AI is creating incredible opportunities for people to solve huge challenges at record speed. Sometimes the first answer from a chatbot is alarmingly better than what I would have come up with, at least just personally. But it's going to be amazing for us all. And we also recognize that these solutions in the data centers that make them possible need energy, and at least at the moment are a primary driver of energy demand, electricity demand in the U.S. How do you see SMRs and new nuclear generally changing the trajectory of your business growth here at Amazon?
Yeah, well, thank you. I think it's a great question. First off, I really want to thank all the speakers to this point. I think it's really encouraging to see such broad bipartisan support, you know, to really steer into what we view not just as AI, but it's, again, it speaks to the national security interest of being, you know, continuing to be really world leaders in AI. We've seen such rapid progress of that over the last few years, but I think we're just at the very beginning of that. And it's not just, I agree, accessing chatbots and getting responses is really eye-opening to what this technology can do, but we're seeing so many use cases for AI that get, you know, much deeper, much more innovative in terms of helping discover new drugs more quickly to bring new kinds of medicines to market, in the case of Pfizer using AI on AWS, as simple as customers like United Airlines using AI just to simplify the passenger experience going through the airports. And so I think we're just at the very beginning of it. It's clear that AI is going to require a lot of power and a lot of data centers. And our focus here is on obviously empowering these with clean, carbon-free energy, and doing so in very close and tight partnership. As you can see on the stage with me, this is something we've been working at for quite a while, and we also recognize that there are a lot of challenges, as sort of Ed was alluding to, a lot of challenges to solve to get from here to there. And so when we started thinking about this kind of announcement or this kind of work, it was not just being at the end of that supply chain of taking the power off of the supply, but what can we do to engage at multiple steps of the way? And that's why, as you can tell, we're investing in X Energy. We're part of that conversation. We've had some amazing conversations with Clay and the team. We're partnering with utilities and energy owners, generation owners, and that's going to be our spirit going forward, is just to continue to engage really at every level, because although the projections are it will take quite a while to bring the full power that we need onto the grid, we think that with that kind of partnership and engagement, we should be able to do it faster. We should be able to do it at less cost. And of course, never compromising on safety. So that's really why we're so engaged with everyone with me on stage and many more partners in the broader space. So that's how we're approaching it.
Well, that's a perfect segue to Secretary Merrick on partnership. Your job is to bring together government, the private sector, academia, all of the communities, all of the stakeholders in the great state here. How do you see this driving forward your plans for economic development and affordable, reliable, ever cleaner energy in the state?
Yes, abundant and innovative as well. Thank you, Craig, and to the speakers here and the distinguished, not extinguished, audience here, Senator Kaine. Let's just think about this. It was said so well by some of our earlier speakers that there really is no other state or commonwealth like Virginia that is poised to lead on nuclear. And a few years ago, Governor Youngkin had what I believe we all share, which is a boldness and a courage to declare this moonshot. So you had a will to do this, but you did need a variety of partners. You definitely needed a regulatory and policy environment, which we have partnered with the federal government and even here in our Commonwealth with Senator Marsden just in our last session, passing a bill that would help offset these costs of developing nuclear. But we also need capital. And so we knew as business people, the governor and I, and most of our cabinet, and Glenn Davis, our director of energy, having come from the private sector, capital was a big part of this. And again, we have partnerships with the federal government. Virginia has just launched its own Clean Energy Innovation Bank. We work very closely with the loan office at the DOE. But I want you to know that we see our role as a both a driver and a convener. We have bi-weekly energy supply chain meetings in commerce and trade, where we bring together experts, and our former secretary, Dan Briot, has been one of our speakers, where we are looking at where should our supply chain be. We have assets in Virginia that we are actively recruiting companies, and we've already extended an invitation to X Energy to do some manufacturing in Virginia. We want to lead in every possible way. We're highly engaged on workforce, not only with the 100,000 people in Virginia who are experts in nuclear, but we have had legislation and we're putting real dollars into training the nuclear workforce from technicians to PhDs. We are committed to that. So we're engaged in recruiting businesses, gaining more capital and investing more capital in workforce, in bipartisan regulatory environment. We're also deeply engaged in investing in sites and in accelerating permitting. And I believe you'll see another executive order from Governor Youngkin coming soon to accelerate permitting on the state level. And yes, Senator Kaye, we appreciate your assistance in accelerating it at the federal level, because that's what we need to do, because we want to compete to win. And that is actually the theme of commerce and trade in the Commonwealth of Virginia. We don't want to just muddling by. We don't want to just status quo, because if you're not growing, you're losing. And so we're here to compete to win with a variety of federal, state, and private sector partners.
I'm now going to come back to Clay and to you, Madam Secretary. This is a nuclear announcement. And so, of course, people will have questions about safety, right? And so I wonder if you can share a little bit about how folks should think about the safety profile of this technology. And, you know, and Kevin, if you want to weigh in as well about how you got to conviction, you know, how you got to conviction on this technology. Clay, do you want to start?
Rich, it's a great question.
I think you might not be on.
Is it on?
Thanks, Kevin. Nuclear power is the safest form of generation that has ever been deployed at scale globally. I want to start with that position. It is the safest form of energy generation that has ever been deployed at scale globally. Now, with our technology at X Energy, we make it yet again safer. We have a fuel form that's made of ceramic and graphite. It's a fuel form that cannot melt. It's the fuel form that the Department of Energy characterizes as the most robust fuel ever invented. And this fuel is the secret sauce in a reactor that we have designed that cannot melt down. So we have made the safest form of generation ever, yet again safer. That allows us to operate on a smaller footprint. It enables better economics. It enables a more welcoming community. And it makes our technology perfectly suited to be paired with industrial facilities, even in communities like data centers. So we'll continue to work to make the case with the communities in which we operate. We believe deeply and strongly in the concept of social license, earning the social license in every community in which we operate. And of course, we have the process at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission where the government assures the protection of the public and the protection of the environment for all of our operations.
Anything to add? That said a lot.
I will say that the Commonwealth of Virginia, we've been deploying small modular reactors in a densely populated region in Hampton Roads area, and we have an unparalleled safety record.
I'm not much more I can add to what Clay has already said, but I would just underscore. I mean, certainly safety and security for AWS are absolutely top priorities, and so, you know, throughout this entire conversation, that's just been one of the invariants in the conversation has been that whatever we do, of course, we'd like to do it faster. We'd like to make it less. We'd like to reduce the cost for it, but there's never any compromise on safety.
Ed, I'm going to come back to you. So the generating new clean electricity is only the beginning of the journey to a data center or a manufacturing facility. You also obviously have to, you know, get the electricity through the transmission and distribution grid, which you all manage with incredible capability, keeping it in equilibrium at all times. What role is your company playing in modernizing the grid and thinking about expanding the grid to enable both the new demand and the new generation here in the state?
Yeah, before I go to that, just on the nuclear safety, just keep in mind, we celebrated 50 years at Surrey last year, 50 years of safe operation of our nuclear fleet. So just, we can operate, own and operate very safely. So on the transmission distribution grid, absolutely. I think at some point you'll have small modular reactors and other, maybe other generation source closer to the load, but until then, you have to get it there. And so we've been making significant investments in our transmission infrastructure. We, over the past decade, we've rebuilt our 500 kV loop across the Commonwealth. That's the backbone. It was originally built as the first 500 kV loop in the world in the 70s, been rebuilt to provide reliability and more capacity. We've been bringing technology to bear. So there's a lot of conversations about GETs, grid enhancing technologies, for example, and advanced conductors. Since 2019, we've been using conductors that can handle temperatures up to 250 degrees C. And so on our transmission right of ways, it's provided 50% more on capacity in those right of ways. The last open window that PJM had, there was about $5 billion worth of transmission that was awarded, $2.5 billion that we would build in the Commonwealth of Virginia. And then more recently, we have a joint planning agreement with AEP and First Energy, where we submitted larger projects, 765 kV projects, within this most latest open window, again, to solve problems for the long term. And so we're focused on making sure that we can serve customers reliably and affordably through our transmission grid. And then on distribution, 2018, the Commonwealth passed the Grid Transformation and Security Act. And the purpose of that was twofold. One, to make the grid more resilient. Second, to better integrate renewables into the grid. Our distribution grid operates at a higher voltage, so there's quite a bit of solar that actually connects on the distribution grid. And so we've been spending, investing in hardening our system, but also in technology to allow us to better integrate renewables, operate our grid reliably each and every day for our customers.
We have a little extra time, so I'm going to ask one additional question. So several of us are going to have the pleasure of going and providing a briefing to congressional staff later this afternoon about this announcement. And obviously, as we've discussed, there's been a significant policy backbone that's enabled this at all levels. Clay, maybe Greg, anyone who wants to weigh in on this, I wonder if you could say a bit more about the policy that's gotten us to this point, how folks at all levels, from the White House to the Department of Energy to Congress to the states, have enabled this, and frankly, what more do we need? So what additional policy support, if any, is needed to actually accomplish the vision that's been laid out here? Clay, would you like to start?
Congress has played a huge role in enabling the technologies for the current energy transition. There's just no question about it. The vision that members of Congress had 5 years ago when they created a program called the Advanced Reactor Demonstration Program is being realized and validated by today's announcement from Amazon, Energy Northwest, and Dominion. That was a program initiated 5 years ago and administered when Dan was running the Energy Department that resulted in two technologies being selected. And X-Energy was proud to be one of them, and our colleagues at TerraPower were the other one. And we are teaming in a public-private partnership, a truly innovative public-private partnership with the Department of Energy and Dow Chemical to bring the first commercial plant online. And now to have that effort validated by the decision of Amazon, Energy Northwest, potentially Dominion and others, to say, yes, we're going to take that technology that the department has demonstrated, and we want to deploy it at great scale, 5 gigawatts in 15 years. Dare I say, it will be the most successful technology creation and demonstration program that the Department of Energy has ever launched. And that really began with the vision of people like Chuck Fleischmann and people like Senator Patty Murray years ago in the House and the Senate. And I'll tell you, on a bipartisan basis, everything that has been enabled for the new nuclear future has been done on a bipartisan, bicameral basis, whether it's the Trump administration, the Biden administration. The policies have been stable, sound, and moving forward.
Greg, you were part of that original announcement from ARDP. Anything to add?
I think beyond ARDP, yep. I mean, we have to talk about the bipartisan infrastructure law. We have to talk about the Inflation Reduction Act and all the things provided there. We intend to apply for and hopefully leverage the DOE loan programs to finance us. Those are going to be critical to this. I think, you know, the ADVANCE Act that was passed recently to look at NRC regulatory reform, incredibly encouraging. In fact, I will just pass on, I was really encouraged to hear a senior leader at the NRC recently who characterized the ADVANCE Act as a tailwind for them. Mm-hmm. That's pretty incredible to think about where we are today in that and what they're trying to do to support this. So I think there's a whole slew of things. You know, I guess it's, you know, we've sort of taken it for granted here today, but stop and think about, you know, how many of us can name one thing in D.C. that the left and the right totally agree on? Well, it's nuclear power, the need for, the need to support it. So that shouldn't be lost on anyone. We shouldn't just gloss over that. But there is some work still that we can do, and I think there's some draft legislation that is intended to be introduced soon. That'll talk about the idea of a cost overrun sort of insurance program. There's some tweaks to some of the Inflation Reduction Act criteria that we would like to see that are particularly useful to us that are in that. You know, so there are a few other things that we still can do to help to make sure that companies like Amazon see that the federal government is still there to back them up on taking these early moves and these early steps while the risks are higher.
Secretary, anything to add on the policy front?
Well, I would say that it's related to policy because whenever we are debating these policies or advancing these policies, we're also educating the public. And that's essential because nuclear is not well understood, and we all have a role to fulfill in helping people understand the safety, the fact that it's increasingly clean and it is clean.
Okay, we're now going to do a little looking into the future. So it's 10 years from now, it's October 2034. Could you all close us out by just taking a minute to say, you know, where do you see your company, your organization, your state, 10 years from now on its journey in deploying clean energy like nuclear energy at scale? Where are you 10 years from now? I'm going to start with Ed at the far end and work back in this direction.
So I mentioned earlier another 27 gigawatts over the next 15 years. So we better be close to at least 20 gigawatts by then. Yeah. But seriously, we need to execute on a lot more solar over the next decade. I'm looking forward to breakthroughs in long duration energy storage. There are a number of technologies that we're working on that I believe help support those investments in renewable. I believe we'll have executed on a second offshore wind project by then. And if the first small modular reactor is not in service, we need to be close to that and probably more already in the pipeline, because there's a lot of work to do over these next 10 years.
Secretary?
Like Ed, we're working on other things besides just new nuclear that we expect to be continuing to develop, including long duration storage projects and solar generation projects. But when you think about what, you know, possibilities this announcement unlocks today, you know, the study I referred to earlier said really for the larger Northwest, that mix, those models decided that it should include over 5 gigawatts of new nuclear. That's pretty significant. The Pacific Northwest Utility Conferencing Committee puts out an annual forecast where they just basically take all the integrated resource plans of the utilities in the region and add them all up. That forecast right now is forecasting almost a 10 gigawatt shortfall in about 10 years. There's plenty of need. So I think what we envision is, as this project, this first four modules that we're deploying from the X Energy technology, as we make strides, as we start to clear certain hurdles and see the risk come down, we expect to be working on modules 5 through 12 right behind that. We have a site right next to the site we're talking about where we can put another 12 modules at least. There is a retired coal site on the west side of our state that we've been in contact with. It could be a viable site. We see the possibilities of this growing significantly in the region. And again, as I mentioned earlier, just, you know, what we see then is also thanks to Amazon's shared vision with us, that's providing an opportunity for utilities to start coming in and getting advantage of this to help meet their growth needs as well.
Rich, my vision for 10 years from today is that through our project execution at X Energy, we will have transformed the way the world thinks about clean, 24/7, reliable power. And that when they think about how to bring clean water and clean air and abundance to every corner of the globe, that they will think of our technology. Now, I think we'll also have plants operating in Texas, in Washington State, in Virginia. I think we will have tens of projects under development in the US, Canada, and the UK. And we will be moving forward with confidence that the clean future that we dream about is in fact possible because of the abundance and beauty of American innovation.
Kevin, can you take us home?
Absolutely. I'm really grateful to be going last because there's so many visions that I'm hearing that I think are very representative and you know, definitely a world that I would like to live in. You know, I take this back to Amazon's commitment as part of our climate pledge to be net zero carbon by 2040. And I think that I'm perhaps very much an optimist, but I believe that in that 10 years time, We will do what's been said on here. We will be on our second or third iteration of really learning from and optimizing, you know, the cost and capability, realizing the benefits that we believe firmly with Generation 4 SMRs in terms of the ability to produce and operate them at scale very safely. And we know that electricity can be one of the lowest cost ways to really decarbonize the entire supply chain. And so I'm very optimistic that in that time we will feel very, very confident about the energy portion, and we'll be able to then translate that into what that means and how we are decarbonizing kind of the long tail, the rest of what I would say is much more expensive typically and much harder to address as part of overall decarbonization. So I'm very optimistic that this is just a very solid foundation for us to build on towards that 2040 goal for us.
Well, I think that's a pretty incredible vision for the next decade. Can you all join me in a round of applause for our amazing panelists in this discussion? And back over to you, Shannon.
Thank you so much, Rich, for, again, joining us today and moderating that session and for the continued partnership that you and SEBA have had with us over the years. As we come to a close of this insightful discussion, I'd like to take a moment to thank again our panelists for sharing this really valuable information and insight to these important innovative agreements, as well as the broader issues and challenges. Your expertise is obviously going to be needed now and in the next decade and beyond, so thank you for being here. I hope the discussion has sparked a lot of ideas and further dialogue about how we can accelerate this important transition as we move forward. We all know that the journey will not be linear and we'll need to innovate and pivot along the way, as we've heard earlier. Developing new sources of carbon-free energy is crucial, and none of us can do this alone. And you've seen that today, these incredible partnerships that we and others have. I want to thank everyone for joining us. We are excited for the future and our ongoing collaboration as we continue on our path to net zero carbon here at Amazon, as Kevin was talking about. Thank you to everyone who tuned in to the live stream as that part of this program concludes. And if the panelists can actually remain on stage for just a minute, we're going to do a quick photo. And then, again, for those of you in the audience, we'd like to thank you for coming, encourage you to mingle for a little bit, have some snacks, including some really cool AWS cookies that are back there that I understand taste really good as well. So thank you all very much for being here, for your partnership, and we again thank everyone for coming.